you for having me here. I've actually had a great weekend so far in Houston, and this actually is my first time in Houston. It's not my first time in Texas, but this is my first time in Houston. So I want to begin by playing a game. I'm going to show you different images, and with each image, I want you to clap if you think the image or the person reflected in it projects feminist values and, in your opinion, challenges stereotypical depictions and assumptions about women. I'm asking you to respond without thinking and to kind of go with your gut. So you're going to clap if you think that the image or the person that you see projects on the screen is somebody who challenges stereotypical depictions about women, all right? Got it? All right. Okay. Yeah, sorry, we got that. All right.
Does the Bible reflect
on the role women play in the narrative, or their place in society. And second, the Bible is inconsistent in how it presents women. Genesis presents women differently than Proverbs. The book of Leviticus legislates women's lives differently than Deuteronomy does. The best we can do when trying to determine the Bible's assumptions and attitudes towards women is to look for common denominators among its laws and narratives that reveal an implicit, inconsistent gender ideology. Recognizing these challenges, I narrow my initial question whether the Bible is a patriarchal book and ask, does the Bible value women? This is the question I will now focus upon. To pull no punches, I answer this question up front and say yes, I believe the Bible values women. Yet, as we will see, I argue that the Bible associates women with particular qualities that contemporary folks may find unappealing and restricting. Thus, the larger question, which I address again in my conclusion, whether to celebrate the Bible as a revolutionary book or to critique it as a patriarchal book, will remain live and unanswered. For the reasons I just mentioned, I believe it is impossible to state definitively the Bible's attitude towards women. Yet I do believe you can say that the Bible reflects a society that privileges its men socially and politically. As an aside, if you're interested in learning more about life in ancient Israel, you may want to read Jenny R. Ebeling's Women's Lives in Biblical Times, Carol Meyer's recently revised and updated Rediscovering Eve. There are three features of ancient Israelite society that shaped the lives of its women, and I believe worked to privilege its men. Ancient Israelite society was patrilineal, patriarchal, and patrilocal. So what do these terms mean? Patrilineal, it means goods and property were passed through the male line. With rare exception, such as the absence of male heirs, daughters and wives did not inherit their father's or their husband's property. Women, therefore, had no tangible legacy and no material security in ancient Israel. As a result, younger women needed fathers or brothers, and older women needed husbands to secure their place in society. Patriarchal, males were heads of households and had legislative and religious authority within the Israelite community. Women, therefore, were subject to the men in their families and community. Patrilocal, when women married, they moved from their natal households into their husband's household. Thus, unmarried women were transient figures in their natal households. Married women, at least initially, were alien figures in their conjugal homes. Given these three elements, I think it is fair to say that ancient Israelite society privileged its men. It created a world in which women had little traction and little security. It was a world in which women were vulnerable figures who needed male protection. A woman's status changed once she had children, but even marriage and motherhood did not guarantee women's security. We can see this world reflected in the Bible. In the book of Genesis, Sarah and Hagar's story demonstrates how women, with or without children, were at their husband's mercy. Sarah and Hagar share one husband. Their husband, Abraham, makes a habit with limited success of giving his wives away. He gives Sarah up twice to the kings of Egypt, as we're going to talk about in a moment, and Gerar. And he sends Hagar into the wilderness. In Genesis 38, Tamar's story illustrates the perils of being a childless widow. The widow Tamar must have sex with her father-in-law, Judah, in order to be reintegrated back into her conjugal home. The Bible reflects a world that privileges men, but the Bible also creates its own world. why these women are front and center in a book whose main concern is securing the patriline of one family, the descendants of Abraham, and their property, the Nachalah of Israel. Given its focus on heirs and property, the Bible should be a story primarily, if not exclusively, about fathers and sons. Fathers and sons should be the heroes of their narratives. The question why women are front and center in the Bible is more than a byproduct of mixed and stir early feminist Bible scholarship. Women are not simply included in the Bible's narrative, and by virtue of being there, warrant our attention or our sympathies. Rather, women are often the narrative's focus and function as the narrative agent. Women like Tamar and Rebecca can even be the heroes of their narratives. Why does the Bible feature women like Tamar, who Judah, the family's patriarch, admits is more righteous than him? Tamar, not Judah, ensures an heir and secures the patriline which results in King David's birth. Why does the Bible feature women like the matriarch Rebecca? It is Rebecca, and not her husband Isaac, who ensures the blessing for their son Jacob and secures his marriage. The answer I offer today is that the Bible features women because the Bible values women. Naturally, women are valued in a world and a narrative concerned with securing heirs. The Bible reflects a world in which a woman's average lifespan was 30, and the birth rate was 2 healthy children for every 4 pregnancies. One could say, as Esther Hughes does in her book Sexual Politics in the Biblical Narrative, that women are in the Bible to have babies, to make sure that male babies are born in order to secure Israel's legacy. Progeny or property? Seen in this way, women like Sarah, Hagar, Rebecca, and Tamar, who ensure their husbands have viable heirs, serve the Bible's patrilineal ideology. Though I recognize a degree of truth to this explanation, I believe it's too narrow. It does not acknowledge the contributions women make to the Bible story beyond their fertility, or the range of roles women assume within the Bible beyond that of expectant and conniving mother. Miriam, Moses' sister, is an example of a biblical woman who does not have a maternal narrative. She is the Carrie Bradshaw of the Bible. Miriam never marries, nor has children, though the rabbis, not unlike the writers of Sex and the City, are uncomfortable with a single woman and marry her off in the midrash. This explanation also does not recognize the complexities of the family narratives that feature women. Certainly, having babies is a major storyline in the family narratives. Fertility is a concern and a value, but I argue it is not the ultimate concern or the ultimate value of these narratives. At heart, the family narratives are about establishing the relationship with God. They are about how humans relate to each other when they are in relationship with God. Fertility is a central factor in their story because it is central to God's relationship with Israel. In the family narratives, fertility indicates faith in God and manifests the blessings of God. Women play an integral part of their story, I suggest, as full participants in the divine-human relationship. No doubt, men have a higher status religiously than women,
as they do socially and politically. They are granted direct access to God, and as priests, become the ones to manage God's presence in Israel. But women participate in the divine-human relationship, and I now argue, more fully represent the human perspective in this relationship than men do. The Bible values women And it is my contention and my thesis that women's experience and perspective are central to Israel's identity and to its theology. In essential ways, Israel perceives itself to be a woman. I now want to explore this further. A moment ago, I said that ancient Israel was patrilineal and patrilocal society. As I mentioned, these features shaped a woman's experience, giving her little traction and little security within Israelite society. Because women were vulnerable and liminal figures within their homes and society, women's experience becomes the template for Israel's experience. A woman's quotidian experience reflects the precariousness of Israel's historical experience and gets integrated into Israel's national narrative. Throughout its history, Israel was at the mercy of three great superpowers of the ancient world, Egypt, Assyria, and Babylon, and experienced exile in all. The experience of being a stranger, of course, is central to Israel's identity and to its national narrative. Every significant figure in the Bible, from Abraham to Moses to David, leaves home and experiences exile. Journeys and the alienation that accompanies them are also fundamental to religious experience in the Bible. Revelation occurs en route for Abraham, Jacob, and Moses. Of course, God first communicates to Israel en route in the wilderness, a landscape of alienation. In significant ways, Israel's story of vulnerability and alienation is a woman's story. Like a woman, Israel and its heroes are asked to leave the security of their homes, and we can see this in Genesis chapter 12, the very first story of Israel's narrative, and I believe
one that functions as a paradigm for it. At the start of this chapter, God commands Abraham, then called Avram, to take a woman's journey. Like a betrothed woman, Avram must leave his natal household in Mesopotamia and head to Israel. Lech lecha ma'artzecha m'maladetcha m'beit avicha. Go, says God, from your land, from your birthplace, from the house of your father. Once Avram arrives in Israel, famine forces him down into Egypt, where he protects his life and property, as I mentioned earlier, by offering his wife, Sarah, called at this point in the narrative Sarai, as his sister to Pharaoh. Indeed, Pharaoh takes Sarai into his house. God then afflicts Pharaoh's house with plagues in order to rescue Sarai and restore her to her home and husband. Narrative details such as famine, Egypt, and plagues make it clear that this story is a mini version of Israel's great mythic history. It foreshadows what is to come, Israel's enslavement in and liberation from Egypt. For me, what is most interesting about this foreshadowing is its focus on Sarah. Sarah is the wife's sister, the twice marked liminal and vulnerable figure in the narrative. She is the stranger at the mercy of foreign power. She is the one who must be saved. In other words, Sarah stands in for Moses, who one day will become a stranger in Pharaoh's house. She also stands in for Israel, who one day God will free from Egypt with plagues. The conflation of Sarah's story with Israel's story suggests that Israel relates to women's experience, particularly to a wife's experience of leaving her natal home and its accompanying feelings of vulnerability and alienation. The Bible validates this experience by recognizing it as foundational and formative, and by incorporating it into its national story. I now take this one step further and suggest that Israel not only relates to women's experience, Israel identifies as a woman. And it does so not because of historical circumstances, but because of its a religious orientation. One of the most common images found in the Bible is the image of daughter Zion, the complicated figure of personified Israel. Her story is told throughout the prophets, as well as in the Book of Lamentations. Putting the pieces of her narrative together, we learn that God loves, woos, and marries daughter Zion. Besotted with his young bride, God adorns her and provides her with her needs. Over time, daughter Zion grows too vain. No longer recognizing God as her provider, Zion looks to others who can satisfy her. She becomes sexually promiscuous. In many ways, daughter Zion becomes like Carrie, Samantha, Miranda, and Charlotte on Sex and the City. She is confident, independent, and sexually aggressive. But God is no Mr. Big. Mr. Big is a commitment-phobic man who happily goes with a commitment-phobic woman. God, on the other hand, demands commitment and loyalty from Israel. Enraged at Zion, God brutally punishes her and severs his relationship with her. Ultimately, the relationship is restored, but on God's terms. The figure of daughter Zion receives a lot of attention, particularly from feminist scholars like Renita J. Weems, who recognize her story as abusive. They read Zion's story as one that satisfies male sexual fantasies and justifies male violence. I offer a different perspective now, one that I hope complicates the narrative but does not seek to whitewash it. What I find most remarkable about Zion's story is that Israel sees itself as a woman married to God. Why do the Bible's male prophets construct and perpetuate this image? Certainly, there are social and historical factors that account for the metaphor, such as the fact that ancient cities like the land were often personified as female. But I believe there are other factors that account for this image. I suggest that the marriage metaphor is essentially a religious metaphor which captures the human experience of being in relationship to the divine. And the human experience, Israel's experience, is manifest as female. It's not surprising to me that the prophets use marriage to describe Israel's relationship with God. The marriage metaphor captures two essential features of this relationship: its hierarchy and its intimacy. In the ancient world, marriage was a hierarchical relationship between husband and wife. A husband exercised control over his wife. A wife submitted to her husband's authority. To be in relationship with God is to submit to God's authority. In essence, to assume the wife's position. This explains the prophet's identification with daughter Zion. It also explains why God favors effeminate, more domestic men in the family narratives, like passive Isaac, domestic Jacob, and emotional Joseph. It also explains why these men must take women's journeys to experience vulnerability and become less manly in order to be in relationship with God. But marriage is not only about a distribution of power. It is also about emotional intimacy. Marriage certainly constructs a hierarchical relationship, but it is also reciprocal. We see this reciprocity in Zion's story as well. God is not an emotionalist despot, coldly determining Israel's fate. God loves Zion and is distraught over her betrayal. Clearly, since she can hurt him, daughter Zion holds emotional power over God. The marriage metaphor therefore affirms Zion's power, a wife's power, to which God, a husband, succumbs. Though angry, he cannot cast off the wife of his youth. Though hurt, God longs to take Zion back and embrace her in love, as the prophet Isaiah writes, "For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with great love I will gather you back." In fury, for a moment, I hid my face from you, but with everlasting compassion, I will love you. In closing, I want to return to the larger, complicated question of whether or not the Bible is a patriarchal text. I have argued that the Bible indeed values women, and not only because they will birth heirs for their husbands, but rather I have argued that women's experience and perspective are fundamental to Israel's identity and to its theology. I have argued that Israel's story, which is a story of vulnerability and alienation, is a woman's story, and that Israel identifies as a woman who is submissive but not powerless in her intimate relationship with God. Vulnerability, alienation, and submission. These are not qualities we tend to celebrate in our world. Yet, these are essential qualities that define Israel's religious experience, and they are qualities the Bible associates with women. Should we celebrate the Bible for recognizing women's experience and considering it to be the substance of religious experience? Or should we critique the Bible for encrypting a woman's secondary status into Israel's mythic narrative? Could we value the qualities of vulnerability, alienation, and submission and find them relevant to our religious lives if not associated with women? These are the questions that occupy my religious and my academic relationship to the Bible, to which I have no easy answers. But I, like all of my colleagues here today, am not interested in easy answers. What I strive to do, what I hope we all do in our time today, is to consider questions like these together. I hope we spend our day looking honestly at our texts and tradition, trying to understand them both as cultural products that may reflect different values, as well as essential, relevant resources for our Jewish lives. I wish us all a productive, stimulating, and inspiring day. Thank you.